So it should be like on their PDF. Yeah. So you'll just close their presentation down. Now, the Adobe is not looking really good, so zooming in will be important. The numbers show well. The map is hard to read. But the PowerPoint is the Adobe is right here. Okay.
Right there.
The Adobe's in the middle.
Yeah, right there.
That was magic. But she said, but she said you can go. When you open up the Adobe, you can go Control L to get it to the full screen, and then if you want to zoom in, you can go Control and then plus.
Okay.
And then she said if you want, and then I guess you can.
Used to go down.
I guess you can use the mouse to pan around.
I only have two exhibits. So.
Yeah. Well, the two exhibits I have, you have more.
Yeah. No. That's what I'm saying.
And then you can go this way to go page up and page down, or escape to go back to the full screen. Yeah.
And here comes Tom. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Durham Planning Commission. The members of the Durham Planning Commission have been appointed by the City Council and the County Board of Commissioners as an advisory board to the elected officials. You should know that the election officials have the final say on any issue before us tonight. If you wish to speak on an agenda item tonight, please go to the table to my left and sign up to speak. For those of you who wish to speak, please state your name and your address clearly when you come to the podium. Please speak clearly and into the microphone. Each side, those speaking in favor of an item and those speaking in opposition to an item, will have 10 minutes to present for each side. The time will be divided among all persons wishing to speak. Finally, all motions are stated in the affirmative. If a motion fails or ties, the recommendation is for denial. Thank you. We're ready for the roll call.
Mr. Alturk.
Present.
Mr. Bryan.
Present.
Mr. Busby.
Present.
Ms. Freeman. Mr. Ghosh.
Present.
Mr. Gibbs. Mr. Harris.
Present.
Mr. Hornbuckle.
Present.
Ms. Hyman.
Present.
Mr. Johnson.
Present.
Mr. Kinchin. Mr. Miller.
Here.
Mr. Van.
Present.
Mr. Whitley.
Let the record show that I have received excused absences for two members, Commissioner Freeman and Commissioner Gibbs.
And I so move.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we approve the absences for Commissioner Gibbs and Commissioner Freeman. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you. Are there any adjustments to the agenda?
Madam Chair, this is Scott Whiteman from the Planning Department. Commissioner Ghosh contacted our office about some concerns with case TC 1602. and talking over what the issues he brought to our attention internally with our attorney's office and our transportation office, we do believe that they deserve some further fleshing out. So we'd request that you defer that item, and we'll bring it back at a later date.
Okay. Are there any adjustments, further adjustments to the agenda?
Do we know how long they want to defer?
Question?
Yeah. We would ask for a deferral, and then we'll bring it back and re-advertise it whenever it's ready.
If there are people here, why don't we just go ahead and get it off the agenda now rather than make them wait through all of this?
Okay. Let me check to see if there are any individuals here to speak on this item, the transportation impact analysis, technical changes. Susan, if you could take a look to see if anybody has signed up. Okay, if there are no additional individuals, if there are no individuals to speak, then we will go ahead and make the adjustment and remove this item.
So I think you need to make a motion to refer it back to staff.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I move that we defer TC 160002 to a future date.
Second.
Commissioner Harris made the motion. Commissioner Busby second that we defer the transportation impact analysis for a later date. All in favor of this motion,
I have a question, if I may, before we vote.
Okay.
Would you prefer that we defer it or continue it?
Well, we have an open agenda.
Okay. Yeah, and we're not sure, not knowing how long it'll take and not wanting to be risking being the only item on your December agenda, we prefer that you just defer it.
An additional question? All in favor of the motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed? The motion carries. Okay. Everybody did not? Was it 11-2? Okay, thank you. Okay, no other adjustments to the agenda, then we will proceed with approval of the minutes.
The record reflect that Commissioner Whitley has arrived and says Commissioner Kinchin.
Yes. Susan, let the record reflect that two additional commissioners have arrived, Commissioner Kinchin and Commissioner Whitley.
Madam Chair, did you want to add something to the agenda under announcements? The appointment?
I'd like to do it when we get there.
No, you need to do it now. You're modifying the agenda now.
Okay, then I'm modifying the agenda. I need to make an announcement about appointments. Board appointments. Anything else? Recognize Commissioner Bryan.
If there are no other changes, I'm going to move that we approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Commissioner Bryan and made the motion. Commissioner Busby, second. All in favor of approving the agenda with the adjustments, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed? Thank you. All right, we'll move to the public hearings. Did we haven't approved the minutes?
We got right up to the edge.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, we need a motion to approve the minutes.
So move.
Second.
Commissioner Bryan has a question.
I'd like to offer a substitute motion, and that is that we approve the minutes with the attached consistency statement.
Second.
Commissioner Brine made the motion to approve the minutes with the attached consistency statement. Commissioner Busby seconded. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand.
Question before you go.
Another question?
You want to tell?
I do have a minor correction to the minutes. Under roll call, Commissioner Busby is listed twice and Commissioner Harris is not listed at all.
Okay.
For the record, I was twice as good in that meeting.
And we brought it to the attention of the clerk, so we've made the adjustment.
Move the question.
All in favor? When we approve the minutes?
No.
Okay. I'm sorry. All in favor of the motion to approve the minutes with the consistency statement approved by the clerk, let it be known by raising your right hand. Gotcha. All opposed? Thank you. Now we have approved the minutes. All right, we're ready for the public hearings. The first item listed, staff report for the first item, which is the towns of South Point, item number Z150042.
Good evening.
Thank you. Wow.
Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I will be presenting zoning case Z150042, the towns at South Point. You previously heard this case at your July 12th meeting. The project did receive a recommendation against at the last meeting. Since that time, the applicant has made changes to the development plan and as such is in front of you again. The changes to this include reducing the density to PDR 5.918. It was previously 7.609. Reducing unit count to 49 units, 48 townhomes, and one single family unit. Removing text commitment 4, which required the construction of a chain link fence. Adding new text commitment 5, which required the development to provide a dog waste station. Add new text commitment number 6, which limits the development to townhomes and the preservation of single family homes. Add new text commitment 7, which requires the development to provide a striped crosswalk across Barbie Road. Revised design commitment 1C with language about color palette and masonry accent. And design commitment 1D, which requires 2 16-inch offset per every building of 4 units or more, and removing the additional approval note regarding the fence. And adjusting the building and parking envelope in the northwest corner of the site. So the rest of this information will be the same as was previously presented, minus those modifications. The applicant for this project is Jason Clayton. It is within the city's jurisdiction. The request is from RS20 to PDR 5.918. The acreage is 8.28 acres. And the request is for 48 townhome units and the preservation of the existing single family home located at 6304 Barbie Road. This project consists of 3 parcels. The site is located at 6300, 6200, and 6304 Barbie Road, directly north of the northwest quadrant of intersection of I-40 and Barbie Road. This project is located within the suburban development tier and the MTC I-40 and FJB watershed overlays. This project does meet the requirements of the PDR zoning district as outlined on the staff and in the development plan in your packet. The existing conditions of page. This site is currently heavily wooded and vacant with the exception of 6308 Barbie Road, which is currently developed as a single family residential home. This project meets the requirements for a development plan for the PDR zoning district. The proposed conditions commits to 2 site access points, one for the single family home and the other located for the rest of the project, the location of the building and parking envelope and general location of tree preservation areas. The development plan also commits to a maximum residential density of 47 residential units, two external site plans. The impervious surface will not exceed 40% or 3.24 acres, a tree coverage of 20%. And as I stated earlier, the geographic commitments are general location of site access points, tree coverage, location of multifamily building and parking envelope, site, and the size and location of project boundary buffers. There is a number of text commitments on this project. They all remain the same with the exception of the ones that I outlined earlier, and they can be found in the following slides.
Okay.
This project is consistent with the future land use map, which designates this area as low medium density residential. Staff has determined that the proposal is consistent with the comprehensive plan and policies outlined on this slide and in the staff report. And staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies and ordinances. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
We have a number of people who have signed up to speak in favor of this project that I'm going to start with. There, it looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so about 2 minutes each, Susan. And we'll start with the first individual for Ken Spaulding.
Good afternoon, members of the Planning Commission. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant in this matter. As was pointed out, you've seen this development previously. You did rule upon it. After that, at that time was 7.6 units an acre. After that, the developers got in touch with me and asked that we assist them on it. We had an agreement that I would work with them and we would work together on it, and we both felt that it was important to get back with the neighborhood and to have continued neighborhood meetings. We did that. We had two neighborhood meetings. The first one, 20 people were there. The second one, 7 people were there. In the interim between that, after the first meeting, the neighborhood representative, Ms. Shonda Allen, called and asked if she could join us and join the team as we went through the issues that the community had raised at the first meeting. And we had a board and we took down each issue. I talked with my clients and they welcomed this. Now, I've been doing this for 30 years. It's the first time that we had neighborhood representatives to meet with the actual working team to be able to see how we could address the issues. And we welcomed her. I want to say that even though I think Ms. Allen has pointed out that they would be opposed to it, regardless that she pointed out that candidly, but at the same time, she worked very professionally with us and in a spirit of just at least trying to address the issues that we could address. And I thank you very much publicly, Shonda, for that. We enjoyed meeting with the residents, with the neighbors. We were able to move forward with it after meeting and had that second meeting, and we were able to point out what we were able to do. I want to also indicate that we did make significant changes. We also, because of the concern that some had regarding the traffic, and we're going to ask that that there will be an additional 2 minutes for me on this because I'm representing some of the pro speakers.
Okay.
And so what we ended up doing, we made significant changes. They had a concern about cut-through traffic, so we hired a traffic engineer to be able to come in and take a look at that so he can report that this evening. I also want to point out that we did reduce it from 62 townhomes to 48 townhomes. We did reduce it from 7.6 acres, the previous one, units per acre, to 5.9 units per acre. We removed the fence. Some people here talked about that. Some might say the dog waste station is a very minor thing, but it was not a minor thing to the neighborhood. So we included that. Also, George will talk to you about the design aspect of it. We repositioned the building to be able to create some more space with at least one or two of the residents there. I want to say that we did meet all of the requirements, the policies, the ordinances, the plans for the city of Durham. We've met that. Barbie Road is 2,000 under capacity trips. We will only be entering our project from Barbie Road, and we will not have entrances and exits into the neighborhood. We're sort of sitting out away from that. We also, I just want to conclude by saying this. We tried very hard to work this out, and we worked well with Shonda. And I want to say to you that not only did we work hard, but it was very important to us to try to create a win-win situation. And we have done the absolute best that we can. We've worked hard on it. It means a lot for us to be able to get your support. That's why we did not go and try to run this to the city council after your vote. We wanted to come back through this process, pay you all the respect that you deserve based on the issues and points that you had previously raised. So that's why we're back in front of you, because we want you to have an opportunity to look at this again, and then hopefully we can go to the city council. So thank you very much for allowing us to come back before you again to let you know what we've done to modify and change this plan. George.
Good evening, I'm George Stanziel, president of Stewart, 115 Cofield Circle in Durham. I'm going to be very quick because Ken covered a lot of this, but I wanted to, so we did have three additional meetings. And what we did is we conducted these meetings truly as sort of a public meeting, and we literally wrote down on pads up on the wall, you know, all of the issues that everybody had. And we tried to then, and then our second meeting that we went back, we actually went through each one of them and tried to address each one of them. And that, and those, and the result of those meetings, you know, were some of the things that Ken talked to. But we did talk about density and unit count. We talked about increased their concern for increased traffic, cut through traffic through their neighborhood. We talked about proximity of units. There are some units that are well over 200 feet away from this project, but there were some that were about 100 and so feet away. So we created more space between in our building envelope that would give more open space between the new units and the existing units. We discussed the fence. Obviously nobody wanted that fence, and we were happy to take it away. We talked about the quality of the buildings. You know, one of the things that we did in reducing the number of units is that we increased the value of the units. The units will sell for more. They'll be finished not much nicer. They'll be slightly bigger in terms of floor plan. So not only did we reduce the number of units, but we increased the quality and the quality of these units. I wanted to introduce to you Rinal Stevenson. Rinal is with Graeme Kemp and Associates. He's a traffic engineer. He'll tell you a little bit about his qualifications, and he'll tell you what we studied. This was not a TIA. It was simply a traffic sort of evaluation.
Good evening, Rinal Stevenson, like George said, with Graeme Kemp and Associates, registered professional engineer in the state of North Carolina. And I've been practicing traffic engineering for over 15 years now, and done a lot of these types of studies, traffic studies in Durham. So what I'm going to walk you through, what I'm going to try to walk you through is real quick is this cut through analysis that we did, this traffic analysis to evaluate the cut through traffic. And I'll show you a couple graphics here. Control L. Okay. I'm gonna go to the next one. Yeah, that one first. Okay. So on the screen, and I know some of the roads may not show up incredibly clearly, but the red arrow illustrates this cut through traffic that would be going from Barbie Road to Fayetteville Road and through the adjacent subdivision. That's Windcrest Drive Road, and then Crooked Creek Parkway. So you can see where the red arrow kind of makes that little dip. That's where it intersects Crooked Creek Parkway. So that's the cut through traffic. That was a concern that we were looking at. And obviously the yellow is our site. So really quickly, what we did was set up video locations, video cameras at these two study locations. and we recorded the traffic at both of those locations, and we determined which cars we were seeing at each location, and that represented a cut-through vehicle. We synced the times up and looked at that and counted those cut-through vehicles. And then we also looked at what kind of potential there is for our site to add to cut-through traffic there. And what we found is that there would be five.
Motion that he be given another 2 minutes for continuance.
Second that.
Second. Okay. It's moved and properly second that we extend the time by an additional 2 minutes. All in favor? All opposed? Continue.
Okay. So we found that there would be five vehicles potentially cutting through this route that you see on the screen now that would be generated from our site in 1 hour. So that's one car every 12 minutes that may be going through there. And what that represents, you can see on this screen, is about 2.3% increase in the morning in traffic that would go through there, and a 1.7% increase in the afternoon. So we're not saying there's going to be nobody that would use this route, but it's going to be very few cars. Now, the other thing that I wanted to show you here, just to help kind of put into perspective here, what this is showing is a larger area. The top boundary on the green is MLK. The eastern boundary is NC-55. The left boundary is Fayetteville. And then the southern boundary is I-40 and NC-54. So what we looked at here was this is the area that folks could potentially be using this route, this Windcrest to Crooked Creek Parkway to cut through. And what you'll see here really quickly is there are about close to 6,000 residential units in this area. And that represents, as you can see there, just over 5,000 peak hour trips that would be generated in this entire area. And so, you know, the five cars that we would add is relatively simple math. The five cars that we would add to the cut-through area is 0.1% of this total traffic in this area. So, again, we just wanted to kind of point out that there, while there could be cut-through traffic, it's going to be relatively small and not really noticeable. The other thing I'd like to point out that has been mentioned is Barbie Road. There's more than adequate capacity on Barbie Road. There's about 2,000 trips remaining under capacity today, and so there will be adequate capacity for that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. The next individual speaking for is Gloria Ault. Gloria Ault. I'm sorry. It's Couch. I'm sorry. Yes. That is a C. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Gloria Couch. I'm at 6122 Barbie Road, and I am for the proposal for the townhomes. I don't have any problem with that, so I am for it. So I'm a resident, and I've been there 5 years, so I'm for it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Couch.
One last a paper. Can you hand that out to another person sent a statement who lives right there on Barbie? We'd like to have passed out to you and to the clerk. You've already passed it out?
We have some additional. Thank you. We have some additional people to speak. Carla Sevilla. Carla?
On behalf of Carla, I just wanted to point out she was going to read the actual statement that you have in front of you. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person that I have listed is Lisa Harvey. Okay. And we have her statement. Thank you. Anyone else who would like to speak for this project before I move to those individuals who are speaking against? George?
I just wanted to make one other comment as it relates to traffic. One of the things that we looked at, and if you look at what we've reduced our density to, it's right in the middle of the 48 units an acre that is suggested in the comp plan, which is very similar to a lot of the development that's around around this site. We did look at what if we were to, from a traffic perspective, what if we were to just do 4 units per acre at single family, because the neighborhood was asking us to look at just doing single family. Believe it or not, at 4 units an acre at single family, that would be about 33 units. It actually generates more traffic than the 48 townhomes that we're proposing. And that's based on generation numbers that the city uses. So I just wanted to point that out. We did look at it. One of the reasons that we looked at this, at that larger area, was because the neighborhood asked us to look at the bigger picture, to look at what the impacts would be, and that's why we presented this larger sort of picture for you, to show you the relatively small impact that this project would have. Thank you.
Thank you. The next individual that I have to speak is Shonda Allen, speaking against. Yes, we're going to allow 3 minutes, Susan, for this next group.
All right, thank you. Good evening. My name is Shonda Allen. I'm the president of the Irwin Woods Homeowners Association, and we are back again before you. We want to thank you for the opportunity to speak once again to the planning commissioners. On July 12th, we were up here with several neighbors, and many of them are on their way. I'm getting texts while I'm sitting there. They're on their way trying to find parking, as well as members from the Crooked Creek neighborhood has joined us this evening to oppose the construction of the townhomes. Now, I do want to say that prior, at the previous meeting, there was a unanimous, unanimous vote by the commission that the rezoning was defeated after myself and several neighbors presented concerns to the board. Since that meeting, Stewart and the developers have revised the number, as they have talked about, the townhomes, and have met with us on 2 occasions, and as they said, with me directly, per my request, and I do want to thank them for doing that and allowing me to be in that meeting. Our neighborhood has continuously asked for, one, nothing, obviously, but if anything, single-family homes. But if townhomes have to be built, we ask for a number of things, but certainly less than the 48 that was presented. On July 27th, we met with Eden's Land developers about rezoning for the commercial land on Barbie and 54. On the 28th, we met with Stewart, of which Ken Spalding was brought in to help facilitate that process. 2 meetings after that occurred, in addition to the one that I had. And over the past month, we have met with Crooked Creek neighbors on 2 occasions in reference to the Duke Medical Center being built on Highway 54 and Crooked Creek Parkway. So we have just been overwhelmed with meetings about proposed rezoning and development that's surrounding our neighborhood. So therefore, I stand before you once again representing the Irwin Woods neighbors, as well as the Crooked Creek neighbors who have joined us tonight, several people still coming in, to oppose the construction of the towns of South Point on Barbie Road. While I personally would prefer single-family homes, as we've talked about, or a significant reduction below the 48, and this is no secret to the developers, I do represent the neighborhood who would be in opposition for the construction of townhomes at the Barbie Road, town of South Point, townhomes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
The next individual I have is Sylvia, and Sylvia, help me with the last name. It's Alamesta. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you for being here as well.
Please state your name.
Sylvia Almestica. I live at 6127 Yellowstone Road. And I am one of the houses that is pretty much adjoining the future townhomes, it seems, that may be there. I am opposed for it. I think we kind of do understand that if something has to be built or if it's, you know, not declined again, that we do appreciate that if our voice would be heard of what it is that we would like to see happen, what will help our neighborhood. I appreciate everything and, you know, bringing in people who are going to see what the traffic is going to be and things like that. But, you know, we've lived in the neighborhood for many years. Some have been there 30, 40 years. I've been there going on 13, and we know what's happening to the area. We know that it's being developed all up Barbie Road, Fayetteville Street, and we have a big Duke Center that's adjoining our other neighborhood. So we're the ones that are going to be affected. You know, some they're going to build them and then they leave, and then we have to deal with the construction. We have to deal with, you know, the increase in the population. So all I ask is that, and I think they've done a really good job, and I do thank you for that, for working with us and trying to do, I think, what's best for the area. And so I do want to say thank you for that, and whatever it is that is chosen, that we keep in mind that these are neighborhoods that we live in. These are our children we're bringing up and our families, and we want safety, you know, all around. So that's it. Thank you.
Jennifer Hodgkinson.
Hello. I'm impressed you got my name right. It is Jennifer Hodgkinson. I live on Windcrest Road. I've lived there for 10 years. I've brought up my two daughters there. We just came from horse riding lessons, so my daughter had to come with me today. I'm speaking because we've had quite a history of traffic through the neighborhood. History of basically, I've never been able to take my child trick-or-treating in our neighborhood. It's been unsafe, traffic-wise. I tried it 1 year, never did it again because of traffic. I am the one who, after a car almost hit us, as I was crossing the road one day, I was walking with my two daughters, dogs across the road. We were almost hit after years and years of seeing this. I finally went door to door, started a petition, went door to door to get speed bumps put on Windcrest. And that has helped immensely, but people that live on Barbie and around Barbie have referred to our neighborhood as the cut-through. I have, my own friends have told me, oh, you live on the cut-through from Barbie to Fayetteville. They have cut through our neighborhood, and it just wasn't safe, and the speed bumps have helped, but the area, they're just building, there's so much building going on in this little concentrated area. The little country roads, the two-lane roads, are just not big enough to support these developments. We were caught off guard this June when our trees started going down on Crooked Creek. Learned that a medical center, five-story medical center with a three-story parking garage is going up on Crooked Creek. And they're proposing another one. We'll be here, we will be here in a couple months about this other parking garage. We're looking at 1,000 cars being parked on Crooked Creek. For the Duke Medical Center, they're expecting almost 6,000 daily trips that this is going to generate. That's the one medical center. Now we've got to deal with the second parking garage that's being proposed right in our neighborhood. It's just a very condensed space, not a lot of room to move Barbie's two-lane roads. We've seen it. We've lived there. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. I have no additional people listed to speak, but I do understand that there are other individuals who would like to speak against this project. I see two hands. Have them, no, right here. Thank you. And then
the gentleman in the back row, would you make your way forward if you want to speak?
Good evening. My name is Sarah Verbeest. I live on 700 Windcrest Road. I have lived there for 20 years, raised two children through Durham Public Schools. Well, the 16-year-old isn't quite through high school yet. We have hopes that we will have two children graduate from high school here. And I also have a doctorate in public health. So issues around safety in neighborhoods is something that I'm concerned about. As well as issues around congestion and pollution in our neighborhood. I also have a teen driver. It's a little terrifying having a teen driver, and I can assure you it's even more terrifying when a teen driver is trying to back out onto a very busy road. So as Jennifer and others of my neighbors have mentioned, we feel like a little tiny neighborhood that is in the middle of a lot of development that is happening very quickly. And we have concerns that without adequate planning and thought, we are going to have a part of Durham that is just a traffic jam. We all already know it gets very trafficky when it rains and I-40 backs up. And so I think our request to you is to bring your expertise, your knowledge, and think about not each project, but think about the impact of each project in this region of South Durham. Thank you.
Thank you. I have no other individuals who have signed up to speak for this item, so at this time I'm going to close the public hearing and bring this item back before the commissioners and give them an opportunity to ask questions. Brian, okay, and to my left, okay. Did I see your hand, Andre? Okay, all right. I'm gonna start with Commissioner Al Turk.
Thanks. I'm looking at attachment 7. The Durham Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission had a couple of recommendations, and I was wondering if the developer has considered those, additional asphalt widening for a bike lane and the pedestrian connection with Windcrest Road.
Good evening, Robert Shunkwood Stewart. We had, for those two items, we did speak to transportation about that, and the policy usually has been is when we're doing a road widening, when we're adding turn lanes to widen the asphalt roads, is that a time when bike lanes would be added. But right now, the cross-section out there of on Barbie Road across the majority of the frontage by about 90% is already 38 feet wide. So without doing a formal widening, transportation felt that we had met the comp plan in terms of not, you know, needing to add the bike lanes. The other question was about the adding a connection to there. So the condition of the right-of-way going up along Barbie Road is inadequate in terms of the slopes and the roadside ditch. So in terms of having to acquire easements, construction easements from public right-of-way from neighbors, it seemed to be quite a challenge. And then also in light of the neighbors not wanting more connections to their neighborhood, we also felt that that was an inappropriate thing to do. What we did do is we did provide a walkway from the southeast corner of our site out to Barbie Road, and then we're providing a crosswalk across Barbie Road that will then connect to the existing apartment project. So this development won't act as an island, but it would give people access, you know, to the apartments and then all the way over to 55. This came out about the idea of adding the dogway stations. So we have some open space that will be providing that southeast area. So the residents had talked about the last planning commission hearing about people walking their dogs through their neighborhood. Well, if I understand it correctly, a lot of people are walking from the other side of Barbie Road down Windcrest to Piney Woods Dog Park instead of going up around Woodlake or Woodcroft Parkway. So in the conversations we've had, well, let's try to encourage people from our neighborhood, instead of going up Barbie Road into Windcrest, let's encourage them to go across Barbie. Good?
Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Chair Hyman. First, I just want to speak to the developers and say that I do appreciate the effort that you guys have put in revamping this plan and in meeting with the neighbors. The neighbors obviously seem to appreciate that as well, as they mentioned. And, you know, I think that what is before us is, the history of this, trying to develop this piece of land kind of speaks for itself. It's a difficult piece to develop. It's been passed up several times. And, you know, there's no doubt that what's before us today is better than what was before us in July. Possibly better than what was previously presented in 2006 or whenever it was. So at any rate, I do appreciate that. I was surprised to see this back at the Planning Commission. Like you said, you could have carried this through to the City Council, and I'm glad that you did not, and that some major changes were made. As far as the density goes, I know that was a concern that's still been raised by the neighbors, despite the reduction. And I mean, I can understand where the neighbors are coming from. However, I'd be remiss if I did not point out that the existing homes are in a R20 zoning, that R20 zoning actually doesn't match the future land use map, what is designated for those. And in fact, I think that the recent development activity or interest in this area with the commercial piece on 54 and Barbie and the medical center, I think it kind of speaks to that. This area is probably underdeveloped for what it is. Now, that doesn't take away from the existing homeowners. I mean, they live there, so they have a legitimate concern about the density. But, you know, to me, it makes sense to put more dense housing close to employment centers and kind of commercial areas. And, you know, we're already seeing that right across the street. Barbie, you have a apartment complex that's being developed that's more dense than what's being proposed here. Only slightly more dense, but more dense nonetheless, and certainly more units. It's a lot more acreage. So, you know, I think that it's consistent with the comprehensive plan, and I can appreciate that, but it's also not at the top end of the comprehensive plan, which would offer, you know, which would suggest 8 units per acre. So I think that this is a nice way to start this transition and start the redevelopment of this area, which apparently is what our comprehensive plan is calling for. Aside from that, you know, I think that a lot of the commitment, I mean, the fact that you met with the neighbors and I saw that there was I think a lot of neighbors showed up at the first one and then fewer showed up at the previous ones. That I don't know what that means, but to me, whether someone would come out and say it or not, I think that at least some people are saying, well, you know, they're doing the best they can, and they've addressed my concerns. Perhaps. Maybe it doesn't mean that, but certainly this presentation today and what we heard from the neighbors today is a lot different than what we heard in July. I'm in favor of this and would encourage the rest of my planning commissioners to vote in favor of this. And, you know, I just like to say I applaud the efforts that you guys have put forward in revamping this plan. It's certainly different than what was in July, and I think it's a lot better. So I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Ghosh. Commissioner Busby?
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, I had a question for Mr. Judge, if you don't mind. And this was, I think, more for my edification, but it may be helpful for everyone. The proponents mentioned the traffic studies and how the proposal for townhouses would actually lead to a reduction in potential traffic compared to single-family housing. And I just wonder if you could give a minute explaining how that worked and how that plays out, essentially.
Yes, Bill Judge with Transportation. On a per unit basis, the townhomes generate less trips per day than single family does. The townhomes generate about 6.5 to 7 trips per day, where a typical single family house generates about 10. So if you had basically the same density by going to the townhomes over single family, it's gonna generate fewer trips.
Okay, great, thank you. And then one other question, Ms. Allen, if you don't mind, if you don't mind coming back to the microphone, I had one follow-up question for you. And similar, as you're coming up to the microphone, I think similar to Commissioner Ghosh, I was not here in July, I was out of state. I did watch the video, and I really appreciate that the proponents, the developers, took the time to sit down with the neighbors. I really appreciate the time that the neighbors put in, and I can feel for you. It sounds like you're quite busy trying to keep up with a very busy, growing part of town. Ms. Allen, what I wanted to ask you, you were very clear in saying you would prefer the single-family homes, mm-hmm. but that if it did need to be townhouses, you would like to see a reduction lower than the 48 units. Was there anything else in the conversations, the multiple conversations, that you had hoped to see in this proposal? Because there have been significant changes that have been made, for sure, but I wanted to give you an opportunity to just share with us, is there anything else that you were hoping to see or that the neighbors and all of you have spoke very well to your concerns here tonight?
Thank you. In the neighborhood, we have had several meetings outside of this meeting as well. We have normal neighborhood meetings, and so a number of the neighbors have said they want single family or nothing. And so the absence of neighbors being here is them not saying that they are in agreement to the townhomes, but they are in opposition of anything. And so they feel that if they, you know, that it's almost a moot point because we have been here, they thought they had won in the last one when it was rejected by the commissioners. And so coming back and coming back and coming back, they're like, we're just not gonna continue fighting. We feel that, they feel that, you know, they're fighting a panel they can't win. So not showing up is not to say we are in agreement with it. It is we are tired. We have been to meeting after meeting after meeting, and our neighborhood just feels like they're being overlooked and inundated with building around us. We are surrounded. So initially we asked for nothing, obviously, single family homes, or no more than 30 townhomes. And so the steward and the developers have worked very hard with us to present the lowest number they could go to was 48. And so the attendance started to really drop off, like, okay, fine, if it's gonna be 48, we can't fight that, we can't continue, we've been fighting, we don't wanna do it, but it seems like no one's listening to us.
Well, and just as a follow-up, and I can understand your perspective on how you feel, mm-hmm. are there any specifics in this proposal, noting that it is 48 units, that you or the neighbors, particularly, I've heard a lot about the traffic concerns here tonight. I can certainly understand that, but I just want to know if are there any other improvements that the neighborhood would like to see addressed in this proposal, or?
Well, I think at the last commission, and I'm not seeing the gentleman from our neighborhood that spoke about that, there are a number of improvements to the neighborhood that we had asked for and that we were still waiting for. There's a lot of things, water runoff, the streets that, you know, our older streets, you know, the pavement, the accommodations to that, with the cut-through traffic and all of the building that's going on around us, it's just going to make things worse, we feel, as far as the runoff, the water runoff, the cut-through traffic. I'm not sure when the, you know, the study was done. But you can imagine with all of the construction going on around us, it is going to increase the traffic. That was our number one issue around the cut-through traffic. People do it every day. With the Duke Center coming, this coming, it is going to create that cut-through. That was number one. The safety of it, we've already started having accidents or had an accident at the entrance of our neighborhood with traffic. So those were the biggest things that we were concerned about.
Great. Okay, thank you. Right, my thank final you. Question, Madam Chair. Just for the proponents, for the developers, just wondering, are there any responses to the concerns about the cut-through traffic? I understand you did the traffic study. You did not have to do that. I appreciate it. But I do understand the argument about the death by a thousand cuts and the cumulative impacts, which were not a part of this study. Is there anything else from your perspective that can be done to address that concern? It strikes me that it is a valid concern for the neighbors.
Well, I think in terms of cut-through traffic, one thing we did do was look at, you know, how much is there today, how much would be there when this other development is built out. And what we did was basically review their traffic studies, because it shows where their traffic's going to come and go and how many cars and that kind of thing. So those studies did show that there would be some additional traffic that would cut through the neighborhood. But I want to kind of go back for a second and tell you what's there today. In the morning rush hour, the morning heaviest hour for traffic, there was 24 cars cutting through this area. In the afternoon, there was 43 in 1 hour, in the heaviest hour in the afternoon. So, and just to let you know, when we looked at the potential future developments in this area, there was a total of 15 in the morning hour that could cut through this area. And in the afternoon, there was a total of 19 that could cut through this area. Now, that does not include our development. As I said earlier, our development is five, you know, in an hour, or, you know, one every 12 minutes. So it's very small. I know, you know, it may seem like there's a lot of traffic out there, but one of the things we looked at in the study was that 88% of the traffic we counted at those locations were from inside the area, inside those neighborhoods. And we were, you know, the cut-through was only, you know, 12% of the traffic in the mornings and 15% of the traffic in the afternoons. So, you know, while there are some folks cutting through there, you know, it's not a significant number. And the other thing that we had in that graphic earlier was there are a number, if you look at the map, there are a number of roads that connect from Barbie to Fayetteville, you know, Woodcroft Parkway, and there's three or four, you know, above that. Obviously 54, you know, cuts through. So, you know, any traffic on Barbie or Fayetteville that wants to, you know, get over, there are multiple ways to go. So I think, you know, there are numerous connections that folks can go. And I think that's why you're seeing that out of the 5,000 or trips we looked at in this area, there's only 24 in the morning and 43 in the afternoon using this. So I did want to point that out as well. Does that answer?
Great. Okay, thank you.
The chair recognizes Commissioner Bryan.
Thank you. I have very mixed emotions about this. I certainly understand where the neighborhood is coming from, and I also know from personal experience that single-family homes don't seem to be on the agenda of developers anymore. We have a townhome development going on right next to where I live. I'm inclined to agree in part with what Commissioner Ghosh said, that this may be about as good as you're going to get. Having said that, I also want to note that I still have concerns about, one, the absence of a bicycle lane. I understand what the developer, where he's coming from, when he doesn't want to put one in, but a lot of people ride bicycles on Barbie Road. We need bicycle lanes on Barbie Road. And it would really be helpful if you guys could put one there. Secondly, the traffic is still a concern of mine. One of the reasons that you see a lot of cut-through traffic coming from Fayetteville Road over to Barbie Road, and I'm part of that cut-through traffic a lot of the times. If you've got film of it, you probably have me on film. but in the evening rush hour, the traffic lights on Fayetteville are so poorly synchronized that if you're coming out of the shopping center where the Kroger is located, you can't make a right turn. Your options are to try to go left, which would take you up to Woodcroft Parkway, or to go straight, which takes you right on the Crooked Creek and through the neighborhood. And just about every time I've done that, I have found that I am not alone. We cut through, we get on Barbie Road, and then a lot of that traffic goes across I-40, across 54, and goes down to South Durham somewhere. So I think cut-through traffic is going to be a problem. It's going to continue to be a problem. And when the that medical center or whatever Duke Medicine is building there is completed, I think it's going to be much worse. And if they put another parking garage down there, I wouldn't want to even think about how bad it could get. So that's all I have to say.
Right. Commissioner Whitley.
My question was answered. I too have some feeling about I do know that Durham is going to grow. In order to meet that growth, we have to develop. And the area that you're living in is one of the fastest growth areas in the city. And I would encourage you to call each of the city council members and tell them that they need to widen roads and have traffic calming for their area to meet the development that's taking place. I wish we had an answer. I don't. I do know, though, that we must meet the need for housing. And I applaud the developers. They went beyond the call of duty. They didn't have to, but they did. And it seems to me it's important that we as commissioners, they've met the needs of the community, they've met the needs of the planning department, I for one will vote to approve this measure. I wish there was another answer, but I don't have it. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Whitley. Commissioner Kitchen.
Yes, first I want to commend the developers, I think, who went back and worked really hard to try to get to yes on this. That's a big deal. I wish more developers would listen to the residents. Then I want to apologize to the residents because I cut through all the time, same as Commissioner Bryan. In fact, I left my office today at 4:30, had to run back home and get something and come back here. I took 40 to Fayetteville. I live in South Durham also. On the way back, I left my home at 5:02 and I got here a little bit late. But I cut down Barbie Road all the way to Fayetteville. And we do it all the time. And you know, I was always taught development follows the roads. And you know, I'm mixed here because there's so many developments in our neighborhoods, all over. I mean, we're just surrounded by it. And the growth really is explosive. And I just don't know what it's going to take for us to deal with the road infrastructure. And I do think, though, and I'm torn here, but I do think that this is the best you're going to get where you are, you know, which is unfortunate. They've done a good job trying to get to this. It's a win. I know it doesn't feel like a win, but it could be much worse. And we see much worse. And I think, I don't know what the answer is either, but we've got to figure out a way to deal with the road infrastructure. You know, one of my best friends just moved to Cary, and I don't like Cary. I like Durham. I'm a Durham guy. But I visit him sometimes now, and I go and I see they're dealing with the road infrastructure in Cary. And, you know, we've got to make a commitment. It's not the developer's fault. They're doing, I mean, we've got to grow. This land is in a prime location. So I'm really torn, but I do appreciate the developers working hard. And I appreciate the residents, too. It's going to get better, really. But if we work together, I think we can create more wins. But we've got to look at the bigger picture. And like Commissioner Whitley, I don't know how we do that. But we got to keep fighting for it. But thanks to the developers and to the residents for their patience.
Thank you. Commissioner Hornwinkel.
Yes, I Mr. Spaulding, I'd like to thank the developers for, you know, their hard work and effort and working with the community. I think it would make, if all plans were brought before us, work this way, this board's job would be much easier. Residents of the area, as everyone has stated, I don't have an answer for it. I wish I did. I can recall as a young deputy sheriff patrolling the roads out there 35 years ago, I never imagined that end of Durham County would be the way it is. You know, I can imagine, I recall action on that way was the old Trip store at 54 and Barbie Chapel Road, and possibly a break-in at Pearson Town School. That was, you know, a lot of the attention that we had down that way. I never would imagine things would have developed this way, but I think I want to commend the developers for coming up with a plan that was presented to me beforehand. I was totally against, but I'll have to say now that I will be totally in support of this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Hornbuckle and Commissioner Van. Thank
you. Thanks to all. We've had a chance to hear and have a moment of reflection from, thank you, a moment of reflection from where we were when we started and initially looked at this versus where we are today. And I'm also of the opinion, I really think that given some of the changes that have occurred, and I would certainly quite understand, of course, of the neighbors and those who are here, but I think I share with my colleagues that, you know, I live by a very simple rule that I wouldn't vote in favor of something unless I would place myself there in that particular situation. And I think this project, I think, offers the opportunity for one important thing for me always is value. And I think the value of the newer structures that will go there will certainly have a tremendous impact, in my estimation, in terms of the land value and house value of your properties. And so the idea of nothing going there is just out the window. Unfortunately, you picked the right location. But unfortunately, you picked the right location. And so I'll say, given some of the changes that have occurred and given the overall package that has been presented, I will be voting in favor of this matter. But I certainly also would tell you again, as has been said, you have the option to go argue for those items like the widening of streets, the bike lanes. I totally agree with that. This area is highly concentrated. It's not going to change, unfortunately. But there are things you can advocate and ask for. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Van and Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. When we looked at this project a couple of months ago, the thing that I was concerned about was density, and density of this parcel against its RS-20 neighbors, and also in comparison to the proposed density against the density of the multifamily projects across the street, across Barbie Road. And I have to say that a reduction from 7.6 to 5.9 is a significant step in the right direction. I am still concerned, however, based upon the way I read the intent statement for PDR and what it's supposed to accomplish, and also the vision that's set out in our comprehensive plan about respecting existing neighborhoods and enhancing them. I don't think that this does it still. I think that 5.92 is close to the 5.94 across the street. And if that's what was prevailed on the west side of Barbie Road, I would be completely untroubled. But I'm still troubled, because if you live in an RS-20 house on Yellowstone Drive or on Windcrest Road, and you back up to a townhouse development that's been clear-cut, and you have a small buffer around there, and then you jump up to 6 units an acre, that's the kind of transition that I just really don't think is appropriate and is what is envisioned in our planning process. I do note that Commissioner Ghosh pointed out that what's on the ground there is out of step with the future land use map. I will remind the commission members, though, that the future land use map is not the zoning and doesn't necessarily reflect what's on the ground. And what's on the ground, it represents the investment of not just treasure, but lives of the citizens of Durham, and that needs to be respected. I understand from the neighbors that they are tired. They have been doing this over and over again. It's hard to maintain the enthusiasm level. People have lives to live, their kids are in school, and it's hard to keep coming back and coming back and coming back. So I hate the idea that that the planning process has built into it a wearing down of resolve. So while this is one of the best development plans that I have seen in a long time and touches a lot of bases that are really important to me, and you have heard me stress them, everything from design all the way up, this is still too dense, and I'm going to vote against it. If it was 5 units an acre, I could live with it, but it's 6 units an acre, and that's too much.
Thank you, Commissioner Miller. Do I have other commissioners who would like to speak? If not, we are going to prepare to vote. Can I get a motion?
Madam Chairman, I move that we send case number Z15-00042 forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
By Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner Bryan, that we move the item forward with a favorable recommendation. I'd like to have a roll call.
Mr. Al Turk? Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Mr. Busby?
Yes.
Mr. Ghosh?
Yes.
Mr. Harris? Mr. Hornbuckle?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
No.
Mr. Johnson?
No.
Mr. Kitchen?
No.
Mr. Miller?
No.
Mr. Van?
Yes.
Mr. Whitley?
Yes.
Motion carries 7-5.
Let's move to the next item. Staff report on, is it Belden Landing? Okay. We'll give them a few minutes to leave.
Chair, Madam Chair.
The chair recognizes Commissioner Ghosh.
I just wanted to bring to your attention that my firm is representing Ample Storage on the third item. And so I would ask that I be recused for that.
Madam Chairman, I move that we excuse Mr. Ghosh from consideration of the item that is 5C on our agenda, zoning case Z150041.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we recuse Mr. Commissioner Ghosh from item number 5C, ample storage. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? I'm sorry, I didn't hear it. Okay. Yes, now, staff.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I'm presenting zoning case Z1600020 Belden Landing. The applicant for this case is Dave Munson. This is within the county's jurisdiction and no annexation is proposed, so it will be heard as a county case. The request is from RS20 to CG, or Commercial General. The acreage is 1.62 acres, and as there is not a development plan with this project, there is not any proffered commitments, and as such, all uses within the CG zoning district shall be allowed, if approved. Site is located in the suburban tier at 810 and 814 Belden La Drive. The site is moderately wooded and is presently used for single-family residences. There are three single-family residences currently on the site. Future land use map designates this area as commercial, and as such, this project is consistent with a future land use map. And as such, staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan ordinances and adopts plan policies. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
I have one individual who has signed up to speak for. Is that David Monson? Come forward, please.
Yes, good evening. My name is David Munson, and I am the applicant for this project. And actually, it's hopefully pretty simple after sitting through the South Point discussions. There are currently three houses on these two lots. They are surrounded, as you can see on the map, by commercial property on three sides, with residential properties being approximately 300 feet back through the western part of the woods there. In any case, my plan for the three houses is to leave them as is, except to upgrade them to commercial space. I've been a landlord here in Durham for 32 years, residential houses, but the idea came to me because so many small business owners, mainly attorneys and people in, likewise for CG zoning, came up to me and asked me if these were for rent for their business. And after trying to work with them, and of course they would have to live there and a part of it and so on and so forth, I spoke to Mr. Taylor and we proceeded to look into the situation of turning these three properties into commercial space. There would be no increase of traffic there. There would be no need to upgrade the utilities there. There is a fire hydrant within the required distance, and basically, I would just be turning these properties into commercial use. So if you have any questions, I'll be glad to try and answer them.
Thank you. I will bring the, are there any other individuals who would like to speak? I have no other individuals listed, so I'm going to close the public hearing and bring it back to the commissioners.
Thank
and
you,
they'll
Madam
be able
Chairman.
To ask questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there commissioners who would like to speak? Okay. Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Kyle, I might take you to task here a little bit because I just want a quick understanding of a couple items. On the zoning map, I'm having trouble understanding what are the surrounding districts? Looks like O and I, and then I'm not quite sure. All in the county, right?
There's a table F in the staff report is a listing of the surrounding zonings. They're OI, CG, CG, RS20, and RS20.
So where is the RS20?
The RS20 is south and west.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Right here and here. Okay. If this rezoning were to get approved, what are the buffering requirements between all of these districts?
Yeah.
Sure.
We'll look it up.
All right, so that was one question, and I know you're looking the answer up. And then I did want to know if by going to a general commercial district, would there be additional parking requirements? I haven't been out there, but I'm assuming these are like driveways. So I'm wondering if there's a parking lot requirement or something like that.
So yes, they will have to meet all requirements for a site plan for the commercial district that they're going to. And if they were to change to a commercial use, they will have to submit a site plan and meet all the requirements for the commercial district. And to answer your question as far as the buffers for a RS20 buffer against a CG, you're looking at a 0.8. For a looking at a 0.6 for an OI to a CG. .4 from the CG to CG.
Thank you. Those are all my questions. Thank you very much.
Okay, Commissioner Bryan, did you have? Okay, Commissioner Busby.
Thank you. I just had two questions. The first question, I guess both are for the proponent, Mr. Monson. I was surprised to see the proposed increase traffic by 2,452 vehicles per day. I was just wondering if you could help illuminate for me.
I believe from reading the information that was sent out, they used the highest whatever building would create the most traffic, and I believe that's a drive-through restaurant or something like that. That's why they say they use the maximum.
Right, and you would expect that this would be lower than that?
Yes, I spoke to, I've emailed Mr. Judge back and forth, and since the houses are under 1,000 square feet each, I suppose if an attorney would use them, there'd be much less per house.
Unless they're a very good attorney. Great, thank you. And my second and final question, I did just want to raise the comment that was provided by the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission. Just wanted to see if you had any comments on that. I'm not sure if you've seen that.
I did see that. I discussed if a development plan would be needed for this, and due to no change of infrastructure or traffic patterns, we did not do a development plan. On the site plan would, I believe, resolve the questions that gentlemen had regarding the upgrades and the parking and so on and the actual layout of those issues.
Okay. Great, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Commissioner Miller.
Thank you. Commissioner Gosch had the same concerns I did about buffering. Is this not a 25-foot buffer, reducible to about 12 feet if you put in a wall or a hedge? You gave us the opacity figure. I was wondering what the buffer depth would be. And while they're checking, so the concern here is that there is a single family house that looked to me like it was occupied immediately to the south, well tended. And then on Peyton Drive behind there are single family homes. And I wanted to make sure that if we went GC, which is not inappropriate under the future land use map, but is way more zoning than the applicant says he needs for his intended purpose. I wanted to make sure that there were some device in there to make sure that the future development of this property maxed out to its full potential under GC would not negatively impact the viability of the properties to the west as single-family homes. And so I wish there was a development plan or something like that that would allow for us to make a commitment that should this property at some future point be developed to a greater potential under GC than just converting the three houses into offices, that we could have make sure that we had adequate buffering. What did you find there?
So the buffers range in size from 20 to 50 feet, and yes, 20. They can reduce them up to 25% using the requirements in the ordinances, which is the wall, et cetera, like you mentioned.
Right, and we still have the alternative model to the computer model. Mm-hmm. Okay. So my concern here is the applicant has said that really what he wants to do is use the three houses for non-residential purposes. Why wouldn't a CN, which to me would be a better transition between the GC at the intersection here, the Miami Highway 70 intersection, would be a better transition to the RS-20 district than the GC. I would feel a lot more comfortable with it, and that would give the applicant a very wide range of non-residential uses for those properties on the scale that he's talking about. I would be much more comfortable voting in favor of this if it were a CN application. So my question for the staff, if I am persuasive, and if the applicant indicated a desire to pursue CN instead of CG, what kind of hoops would we require him to jump through at this point?
So just a point of clarification about your buffer question earlier before I answer that question. The interactive buffer method that you mentioned, we just did look it up. You're only allowed to use that if there's a slope greater than 15%. And to answer your next question, they'd have to repay the advertising fee and change the application.
So start over again?
Not quite, but almost.
All right. One last thing before I surrender the mic, if I may, Madam Chairman. The applicant, Mr. Munson, who was, by the way, the star basketball player of my high school team who was 2 years ahead of me, and we loved to watch him play. It was just 6 years ago when we were in high school together. Would you be interested in converting your request from GC to a CN, which is a lesser commercial category and more compatible with residential neighbors behind you and to the south?
I'm really not that familiar with what CN you say.
That's the commercial neighborhood zone. It allows significantly less intensity than CG would, but it certainly would allow you to use the three existing structures for non-residential uses for a range of retail and office uses.
I would consider it. I guess I went the CG route just because that was a long-term, you know, future land use for Durham. And I'm not sure what it would entail going back to try and do CN now or apply for CN.
They would charge you to mail out the advertising again.
Okay, yeah, I don't know if, you know, they would require me to do another impact analysis of traffic and the infrastructure if I needed that or what have you.
They would, if they didn't require it for your GC your CG application, they wouldn't. I don't think they would require it for a CN application since that's a request for a significantly less intense zoning category. I believe that's correct. Is that correct, staff?
TIAs are not required for any project that does not require a development plan.
That's all I have, Madam Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. The only thing we can do is address the item that is before us. And are there any additional questions from our commissioners? If not, then Commissioner Whitley.
Yes, I want to bring to your attention that what we have before us is a commercial, putting a commercial in the middle of residential neighborhood. And we'll be setting a precedent. And we've seen what happens when we do that. You know, and especially when you cannot control once it's done, you cannot control what happens in future years. I cannot vote for this change. I do not want commercial coming right next to my house. I live in a residential neighborhood, so I cannot vote for this.
Are there additional comments? Then I think I need a motion.
Madam Chair, I move we send Z160020 forward with a favorable recommendation.
It has been a motion by Commissioner Harris and second by Commissioner Bryan that we move the Belden Landing Z160020 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this item, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Okay, if you can just hold them for a moment. So is it five? Motion carries 7-5.
Okay. Let's move to the next item. Staff report for ample storage.
Madam Chair, I'm going to step down.
Before we start this item, I'd just like to affirm that planning staff has conducted all notice requirements in accordance with general statutes and ordinances, and affidavits as such have been on file for these cases. And again, Kyle Taylor of the Planning Department, and I will be presenting zoning case Z15-00041, which is ample storage 5239 NC Highway 55. The applicant for this case is Terry Witherington. Sorry if I'm saying that wrong. With Ample Storage Lake Worth LLC. This is a city project. It is within the city's jurisdiction, sorry. The request is from CND to CGD. The acreage is 4.04 acres, and it is for a proposal of 175 square foot maximum building floor area to allow for self-storage and accessory uses. This is a single parcel located within the suburban tier. The site is located at 5239 NC Highway 55 and is in the FJB watershed overlay protection. This site does meet the requirements for the CG zoning district as outlined in this slide, the staff report, and the development plan. The parcel is currently wooded and is relatively flat with a gradual slope towards NC Highway 55. A portion of an existing detention pond is located on this parcel to the northwest quadrant. This project meets the requirements for a development plan in the CG zoning district. The proposed distance page commits to one access point, tree coverage areas, the building and parking envelope, and size and location of building project boundary buffers. The commitments of this plan include the maximum floor area of 175,000 square feet, one side access point, impervious surface maximum of 70%, and tree coverage of 10%. Graphically, this plan commits to the location of site access points, location of tree preservation areas, building and parking envelope, and the size and location of project boundary buffers. There's only one text commitment for this project, and that is the use shall be self-storage and accessory uses. This project is located in the commercial future land use category on the future land use map and therefore is consistent with the comprehensive plan. Staff has determined that the proposal is consistent with the comprehensive plan and policies outlined on this slide. And staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan, policies, and ordinances. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
Thank you. I have one individual signed up to speak. Jennifer Oxford.
Good evening, Chairwoman Hyman, Vice Chair Busby, and members of the Planning Commission. My name is Jennifer Oxford, and I'm an attorney with Morningstar Law Group. I represent the applicant, Ample Storage Lake Worth LLC, and I have with me tonight Terry Witherington of Ample Storage, and also Patty Hildreth, engineer with CMS Engineering, and we're available to answer any questions you might have. I think Kyle did a thorough job, but I'd just like to emphasize that this is an infill project. It's consistent with the adjacent uses. That includes an auto shop to the north, an active rail line to the east, and to the south, a storage facility. Ample Storage provides top quality storage facilities, and this rezoning would reduce the traffic from the maximum generated trips by about 1,000 trips. We respectfully ask for your approval of this rezoning. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any additional people who would like to speak to this item? If not, I will close the public hearing and give the commissioners an opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to commend the applicant for having a real good working relationship with our neighbors to the north. This has enabled them to avoid having another curb cut on Highway 55. And My understanding from a discussion I had with Mr. Biker is that they'll work together with using the stormwater facility that already exists to take care of this particular application. And if you drive on this section of NC 55 very often, you know that it can get a lot of traffic which doesn't seem to know what the speed limit is. And anything that can reduce traffic on this portion of NC 55, I'm going to support. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Johnson?
To the applicant, so in response to that comment, can you educate me on how do you reduce traffic by 1,000 trips by turning a vacant parcel of land into a developed site?
Engineer with CMS Engineering, and the reduction comes from the change in the zoning. The maximum use with the existing zoning would create 1,000 more trips a day than the use that we're proposing.
Mm-hmm. Are there any additional comments? Yes, Commissioner Miller.
For the applicant, what is, in this context, what is an associated accessory use to self-storage? I'm not sure is that something that's contemplated in the code? Okay, anybody that can answer that.
I'm Terry Weddington. I work for Ample Storage. Mm-hmm. I think they're referring there to the manager's apartment on site as accessory use.
All right.
The office that would lease the individual storage units, but that's all that would exist on the property.
All right, I'm completely comfortable with that. Thank you.
Yes, Commissioner Busby.
At the appropriate time, I'd be ready to make a motion.
The time is appropriate.
Great, thank you. Madam Chair, I would make a motion to move forward with a favorable recommendation to the City Council for case number Z150041.
Second.
Who was the second? Motion by Commissioner Busby, second by Commissioner Miller, that we move item number Z150041 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this action, let it be known by raising your right hand high. All opposed?
Motion carries.
Thank you. We have one additional item, Shiloh Assemblage. Staff report, please. Now, are there hearings for these as well?
Good evening again. Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I'll be presenting zoning case Z160021, Shiloh Assemblage. The applicant for this project is Michael Kane. This project is currently located within the county's jurisdiction. However, an annexation is associated with this application, and therefore it will be treated as a city case. And those items will go forward as a consolidated item to the City Council. The request here is from RR to IL. The acreage is 2.8 acres, and the use allowed here will be any use allowed within the IL zoning district, because again, this project has no development plan associated with it, and it will be a general use zoning district. Site is located within the suburban tier at 831 Slater Road at the intersection of Slater Road and 540 and Shiloh Glen Road. Site is currently vacant and heavily wooded, and again is located right at the intersection. This request is consistent with the comprehensive plan, which designates this area as industrial. And staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and ordinances and other adopted policies, and staff is available for any questions. Thank you.
Susan, are there any individuals who have signed up to speak for? Okay, there's one person at the mic. Michael Kane.
Yes, evening. My name's Michael Kane, Capital Civil Engineering, 1011 Pemberton Hill Road in Apex. Appreciate your time. Thank you, Kyle. A busy evening for you. This is hopefully fairly straightforward. I just wanted to let you know that the applicant for this project, or the developer for this project, is committed to this property. This isn't, a lot of times we bring cases forward where we're in contract and trying to see what we can get, what we want to move forward. But he has already purchased this land, the land to the west and to the south, which are all IL zoned. He is from out of state, but has 7 buildings in 5 different properties that we currently have in process in Durham, up near TW Alexander. So it's been very active in this market, and we just ask for your support in moving this forward to town council. I'm here if you have any questions.
Thank you. I'm going to close the public hearing and give the commissioners an opportunity to ask questions, comments. Commissioner, I'll start with Commissioner Brine, Commissioner Busby.
I believe staff made the point that this property is going to be, there's a petition to annex it into the city.
Correct.
Are the other two properties also going to be annexed or
yes.
have? Okay, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Commissioner Busby.
Great, thank you, Madam Chairman. Another question. So it looks like on your proposal, the current plannings for office buildings, flex or warehouse type use, under the IL designation, it looks like there's also the ability to put junkyards, warehouses, and recycling centers within that designation. And so just one question is willingness to potentially make a commitment that we would not be putting a junkyard in this particular location.
This is a general use zoning district, so they cannot proffer
okay.
a official commitment.
Great, okay. However,
that
said, thank you, staff.
That said, it's definitely not the plan to put junkyards here. We have looked at warehouses, we've looked at offices. The current leaning is well towards office. In fact, I'm working on a site plan that we plan to turn on in soon that will have 2 office buildings. One would be a 4-story. Big reason for that, proximity to the freeway and makes for a prime office location.
Thank you. I would agree. This is a good spot for almost anything but a junkyard. So
yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any additional comments? If not, I'm ready for a motion for shallow assemblage.
Madam Chair, I move that we send case Z160021, the shallow assemblage rezoning, forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner Whitley that we send the Shiloh Assemblage case number Z160021 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 12-0.
Thank you. Thank you. Moving to the next items, text amendments, WCF technical changes. Staff report, please.
Good evening. I'm Scott Whiteman with the City County Planning Department. Text amendment TC-1601 proposes technical amendments to paragraph 5.3.3N, wireless communication facilities for transmitting and receiving electronic signals, better known as WCFs. of the Unified Development Ordinance. Substantial revisions to the overall WCF regulations within paragraph 5.3.3N were approved by the City Council and the Board of Commissioners in 2015. Since that time, staff has received applications for various WCF facilities and have monitored whether technical issues with these regulations have arisen and warrant corrections. Staff has identified a set of technical amendments necessary to maintain the policy direction established by adopting the new standards in 2015 and maintain compliance with applicable state and federal law. The proposed amendments are as follows. Require specifying existing and intended service providers. Revise the method for measuring setbacks for freestanding WCFs to be from the tower base instead of the edge of the compound. Revise the requirement to comply with setbacks in order to qualify as an eligible facility request. Clarify the permissibility of freestanding non-concealed WCFs in the RS districts and the allowable height for the RS 20 district. As it's currently written, it would apply in all RS districts, and we believe the original intent was to only apply in the RS 20 district. And to add the definition for fall zone and geographic search ring in to be consistent with state statute. This text amendment has been reviewed by the Joint City County Planning Committee and as well as both the city and county attorney's offices. The staff would recommend approval of this amendment, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any additional individuals who've signed up to speak, so I'm simply going to bring this back to the commissioners and give them an opportunity to ask questions. So let's, yes, Mr. Commissioner Alter.
Yeah, I'm just curious, just out of curiosity, why the current or intended service provider should be indicated on the site plan, or why that's, maybe it's good practice or something.
It's something that's allowed under state law and something that was some of the interested parties have expressed interest in us doing. We can't deny an application based on that, but we believe it's helpful information to have.
Any additional commissioners wishing to speak? Commissioner Bryan?
Just a question. What sort of input have the people who do wireless communication facilities had on these proposals?
We did share it with them, and they seemed comfortable with what we proposed.
Thank you.
I have a question for me. Okay. Oh, well, no, you.
Commissioner Ghosh, and then Commissioner Miller.
Sorry, excuse me. Thank you, Madam Chair. I had a question about the height in RS 20 district. Is that just in recognition of that the maximum height in the RS 20 district is 35 feet?
That's an excellent question. I'm going to have to remind myself what the text actually says. As you might imagine, Mr. Stock would normally be here doing this, but he's observing Yom Kippur tonight, so I'm filling in the best I can.
Well, you're doing wonderful.
You did a great
thank
job.
You look great.
Yeah. I knew I looked great, but am I doing? Do I know anything about what's in here? Thank you, Commissioner Harris.
That's right. Yeah, it's on page 5.
Yeah, that's correct. So it would, in the RS 20 district, the maximum height would.
It's 35 feet.
Would be 35 feet, which is the base district height.
So you just clarify. All right, that's what I thought. Yeah. I just wanted to make sure. I was wondering what the technical issue was there. But.
Thank you. Then Commissioner Miller.
And if you know, can you tell us why we are changing the setback from the compound limit to the base of the pole?
Well, it wasn't explicitly clear in the what was drafted, and what we found is if people are co-locating, they often need to expand the compound, and with the setback being based now on the height of the tower, you're not increasing the danger of it falling onto any other properties. So this just makes it seems a fairer and fair way to administer the regulations.
Thank you.
I'm ready for the motion.
Madam Chair, I move we send text amendment TC16-01 forward with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Harris, second by Commissioner Busby, that we send item CWCF technical changes number TC16-00001 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be.
I've got one question.
Call for the question.
It goes to staff. Just based off the forms you gave us, the text amendment has to be consistent with the comprehensive plan. Is that right?
Yeah, so any change to the zoning ordinance, which would be a text amendment or a zoning map change, by state law, you have to declare that it's consistency with the comprehensive plan, or declare that it's not consistent, but that you're going to approve it anyway. So that's why.
Okay.
Again, but are you ready for the question?
I have a follow-up question, since this was a big issue, ultimately, in the case that the Colony Park case. In Section 3 or Article 3 of the UDO, there is the requirement that at least that zoning map changes be consistent with the comprehensive plan. Does that also obtain with text amendments?
It does not. That specifically applies to zoning map changes.
All right. That's what I thought, but I...
And as you might imagine, it's a lot easier to determine whether or not a zoning map change is consistent with the comprehensive plan than a text amendment.
I disagree with you, and I think we ought to probably revisit that handcuff provision at some point. We ought to look at that, but not tonight.
Are we ready for the question? All in favor, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed?
Motion carries 12-0.
And moving to our next item, historic preservation and other process changes, a text amendment, item number TC16-00004, staff report.
Good evening again. Text amendment TC16-04 is an amendment initiated by the Planning Department to make corrections and clarifications and reorganize sections of the UDO related to certificates of appropriateness and review procedures for various applications, as well as some requirements for notification. There's a summary within your staff report, and I'm happy to answer any questions about any of the details. And staff would recommend approval.
Thank you. Commissioner comments?
Oh, you, what's the public hearing?
Oh, I didn't have anything.
We should open and close.
Okay, let me close the public hearing. I did not have any individuals to sign up for this, so thank you, and I'll close it and bring it back before the commissioners and start with Commissioner Brine. To my right, are there any other individuals who would like to sign up to speak for this on this side? And Commissioner Miller. I have two individuals in queue, Commissioner Brine and then Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a question on page 7. This is the 3.16.2 subsection D. Action by the Historic Preservation Commission. Paragraph 2 says that the HPC shall review the proposed historic district designation in the Historic District Preservation Plan and shall recommend to the appropriate governing body denial of the request or designation of the area. I think you mean to say it shall recommend either approval or denial.
Yes. So, Commissioner Brine, this is not changing text, and it appears that the text used for context is missing two very important words, and we'll make sure we correct that before it goes to the governing body.
Thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. On page 2 in 3.2.2, pre-application conference A, in the third line there, it says is scheduled. Tell me if you're with me. And I believe the form of the verb to be required there in the command form is be, not is.
I do believe you're right, Commissioner Miller.
Well, I had my moments.
We'll fix that.
And then on page 3, there's a table that has procedure, and then the next heading is property owner, and then there is another column there that does not appear to have a heading to describe what that column represents. And I wondered whether it was meant to talk about institutional or organizations that might be entitled to notice. I'm not sure when it says all in that column, who's all?
So that would mean that if there's a text amendment to the comprehensive plan, all registered neighborhood organizations would receive notice of it.
I agree, but what you're missing is see where it says in the previous columns, it says property owner? You don't have a heading. So I think you're just missing something that refers to some sort of institutional or organizational person entitled to notice.
We understand what you're saying, and that makes sense.
And then if you would follow me over back to page 7 again, in the red there under 3.16.2b2 in the proposed language, it's just a recommendation. It's technically correct, but it's written in the passive voice, and it could be written, at least some of it, in the active voice, and I think the meaning would come through clear. And then I have one other thing here that has bothered me for a while. On page 9, on page 9, again, this is in the context language. So this is 3.17.1a. After the red strike through, it says, shall be erected, altered, restored, moved, or demolished with or on such historic district or historic landmark. And I think it would read better if it said, demolished within such historic district or on a historic landmark or such historic landmark, rather than to have within or on and then on again. It's just awkward.
We think.
And then finally, I can remember a case not long ago where there was a lot of discussion about to what extent a COA would be required of the city when it was doing work on the city rights of way, like with trees, curbs, streets, et cetera, and there was a lot of hand-wringing and dissatisfaction with that. B seems to declare definitively that you have to get a COA, and that's for the city, the county, and public utility companies. But on Sunday, a public utility company was out in Club Boulevard making dramatic changes to power poles. I'm glad that they did not have to wait until they got a COA, because my power came back on Sunday. But so at some point, I think that we really need to contemplate this and delineate this a little bit more effectively about when a COA is required, like under emergency situations and what have you. I mean, because a utility company that comes out and changes power poles, they're not getting COAs. And Or I don't know, maybe they're calling up if they're and getting administrative COAs. Yeah, that's what they're doing. Let's move on. I don't know, but I remember that case.
Let me address that.
I would love to hear.
This just sets out the basic parameters. Mm-hmm. There are two other documents that are very important. One is the local review criteria that sets out what is considered maintenance that does not require a COA. And then, and you'll see in part of this that we took out maintenance stuff because it's in the criteria. And so as long as we have it in one place, we don't have to rectify two different documents.
Right.
The second thing is that the commission has adopted rules in their rules of procedure, different mm-hmm. levels of scope of work that entail different approvals, whether a minor work COA or a major work COA. And they just recently updated that to jive with all of this. And so that has a provision in it for emergency repairs. I will tell you that the utility companies in the whole 16 years I've been here have never, ever once applied for a COA. Generally, we consider most of what they do to be maintenance of their utility equipment, usually in the right-of-way.
Sure. And I suppose that the issue would come up if they were proposing to erect a structure that was not previously there or something like that.
Correct.
I'm cool with that. Finally, the last thing, on page 14, 3.17.6, COA for demolition, destruction, and relocation. And this has been something that has worried me because when the statute was adopted and when we first adopted our rules about what the Historic Preservation Commission was supposed to do when somebody has asked for a demolition. And the way that I read it is that they could set any delay up to 365 days, and that later, if the amount of time they set it as a delay was found to be burdensome, that the person who had gotten the COA could come back and ask for relief from that. That's the way I read it. The way that this seems to be written, though, is that we start off with an automatic 365-day delay, and that we reduce it if at that initial hearing the applicant makes a good case for a shorter period of time. In other words, I had envisioned kind of a two-step process. You get the commission sets the initial delay, and then maybe later, if that's too burdensome, the applicant could come back and ask for relief from that initial setting. This seems to contemplate that it's all going to happen at once, and that it's going to be 365 days unless the applicant at that hearing can justify a shorter period of time. Am I reading it right?
Sarah Young, again, with the Planning Department. Yes, by practice, that is the way that it has worked. Again, for as long as I've been involved with the commission, they usually start at the 365 days, and then it's up to the applicant on the record through the quasi-judicial process to put on the record reasons why they should not be delayed the full amount of time. And the commission has, in certain circumstances, for instance, the demolition of a non-contributing structure in bad disrepair,
sure,
or something like that, reduced it. So
sure,
that is how it has worked.
Since that's the case, and I'm not going to argue with that, I'm cool with that. The language in A here, and I'm in the third line of A that begins, however, the effective date of such a COA may be delayed. Perhaps it should say shall be delayed, or maybe we should say in a case where the commission determines to delay and not immediately grant the demolition COA, that the delay shall be 365 days unless the applicant can justify a shorter period. Because this seems to be saying two things at once. That when I read May there, it says that the commission can set the amount of the delay, when in fact what we mean is we're going to start off with 365 days. And that seems to me, with an extra sentence in there, we could make it clear the way we want it to work here in Durham.
I hear your comment.
But you're not buying it.
But I'm not buying it. I will say that the commission, I think, does a pretty good job of vetting out, and I don't know that we necessarily need to hamstring them with more shalls and
Well, no, I wasn't proposing to hamstring it. I just wanted it to be clear to the user who's not familiar with the procedure. The unaccustomed reader, but that's okay. I had my hearing. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, staff.
I was just about to ask the staff a question so to be clear about what this body is going to be voting on. So we're voting on the item as presented and not
all of the additional changes that were you making these adjustments as you are we simply voting on this document the way that it is presented to this body?
I think just to make it clean and clear, you're voting on the item as presented and the staff has agreed to make the changes and we will make them in a way that we think will make you proud.
Thank you. I think we're ready for a motion.
Yes, Elaine, you want to say it?
Madam Chairman, I move that we send the text changes embodied in 16 quad, however many zeros that is, four, forward to the City Council and Board of County Commissioners with a favorable recommendation, realizing that the staff will make such changes as they think are necessary in response to our comments, and that we will be proud of that.
Second.
Can I? A motion by Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner Harris to send item TC1600004 forward with a favorable recommendation and additional proud amendments. All in favor of this action, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed? Ayes have it. Hands have it. Thank you. Under announcements, as the new chair of the Planning Commission, one of our duties is to handle appointments for the various committees that report to. I'm going to defer to Commissioner Busby because during this process, I asked him if he would handle this for me. And so I'm going to defer to Commissioner Busby at this time.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. She asked me to make her proud. Our task was to identify three appointments from the Planning Commission to additional bodies that are part of the Planning Department. And so we have the Joint City-County Planning Committee. Commissioner Harris has committed to continue his role, which we appreciate. Thank you. I have been the representative to the Durham Open Space and Trails Commission. I will also plan to continue that role. The final committee is the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission. And at this point, we actually do not have a representative, but I would certainly open the floor to anyone who is ready and willing to play that role.
Mr. Busby, if I may, I'm going to nominate Mr. Al Turk for that position.
I believe he should accept before we move forward.
Thank you. I'll accept.
Great. Thank you. We appreciate it, especially knowing that you have big changes, fun, positive changes coming to your world in the next few weeks. In advance, congratulations on a soon-to-arrive child.
Thank you, Commissioner Busby, for assisting with that task. And if there is no further business, motion to adjourn. It's like out of here.